Okay, good morning everyone. For today's lecture, we are going to discuss the topic that is purification of salts and their optical properties. In the previous lecture, we have seen what are colloids, what are different types of colloid, how we have classified them into different categories according to their properties. And then we saw how we can prepare colloid. So we saw different approaches for the preparation of colloidal salts. And now we will see, after the preparation of the salts, what are the methods to purify them, right? Whenever you have prepared a salt, salt is a colloidal solution in which we have some solid particle dispersed in the dispersion medium of liquid or gas, or it can be a solid as well. So we have seen so many examples, and then we saw how to prepare salts. So after the salts are formed, it is quite a possibility that they may have certain impurities present in them, and these impurities are basically incorporated during their preparation. When you are preparing them, it is quite a possibility that some ionic substances have entered into the salt. It may have impurity of some ionic ions, or some other substances may have formed, some byproducts could be present. So in order to get pure salt, what are the methods that we need to apply? So, colloidal solutions, when they are prepared, they generally contain excessive amount of electrolytes and some other soluble impurities. So, both of them could be present, or any one of them could be present here. While the presence of traces of electrolyte is essential for the stability of the colloidal solution, but whenever the larger quantities are present, they will coagulate it. Why? Because in that case, it will neutralize the charge over the particles. So if traces of electrolyte is present, then it is okay. But when the larger quantity is there of the electrolyte, then what will happen? It will destabilize the colloid, and after some time, the colloid will be destroyed. So what do you mean by the destruction of the colloid? It is basically conversion of colloid into suspension. So when the particles of the colloid, they coalesce together, they agglomerate and they form large size particles, what will happen? All the particles will settle down at the bottom of the container, and your colloid is destroyed. So the stability of colloid is actually when the particles are there in the dispersion medium. They should be dispersed in the dispersion medium, otherwise the colloid will be destroyed. So after the destruction of colloid, the colloidal solution is converted into a suspension. So the purification of the colloid solution is also required to increase the stability of the colloid, or you can say to increase its shelf life. So in order to make it stable for a longer duration of time, these electrolytes which are present in the form of impurity, these need to be removed from the colloidal solution. So it is very much necessary to reduce the concentration of these soluble impurities to a requisite minimum. Okay, so you cannot remove them completely, but you can reduce the quantity, you can reduce the concentration of these impurities to a minimum level. So the process which is used for the reducing a number of the impurity to a requisite minimum is known as purification of the colloidal solution. So during the purification, what you are doing, you are reducing the concentration of the impurities to a requisite minimum. So let us look what are the methods. So for the purification of colloidal solutions, we have four different methods. First is the dialysis, then electrodialysis, ultrafiltration, and we have ultracentrifugation. These four methods, they are available for the purification of a colloidal solution. Now let us discuss them one by one. First is the dialysis. What is dialysis? It is process of removing a dissolved substance from the colloidal solution by a means of diffusion through a suitable membrane. So that suitable membrane will be my semi-permeable membrane, right? What does it mean, semi-permeable membrane? So such type of membranes, they allow the passage of only a certain type of particles and block all the others. So a semi-permeable membrane, it will allow the passage of electrolytes, right? Because it will allow small size particles through it. But a larger size particle, like the colloidal particle, they will not be allowed to pass through the membrane. So therefore, if you keep two solutions separated by the semi-permeable membrane, on one part if you have a colloidal solution and on the other part if you have any other very dilute solution, then what will happen? There will be diffusion of the electrolyte from inside to the outside, and that will be under the concentration gradient. It will be the driving force will be the concentration gradient of the electrolyte. So since the particles like ions or the smaller molecules in the true solution, these are what, whenever they are present in the colloidal solve, basically they are forming the true solution with the dispersion medium. So they can pass through the enamel membrane or parchment membrane or cellophane sheet. They are all what? They are all semi-permeable membranes. But not the colloidal particle. The membrane can be used for dialysis. So the colloidal particle, they are not able to pass through the semi-permeable membrane. And the colloidal particles are not passing through the membrane, but the electrolytes, or you can see the ions, because they are of smaller size, they will pass through the membrane. And this is the very basic concept of the process of dialysis. The apparatus used for this purpose is called what? Dialyzer. And it contains a bag of suitable membrane containing the colloidal solution is suspended in a vessel through which fresh water is continuously flowing. So if the fresh water is there on the outside of the membrane, then what will happen? Inside you have electrolytes present in the dispersion medium, and outside you have a fresh water. So the concentration of the electrolytes or ions, you can say, is higher in the inside of the membrane, and it is nil outside the membrane. So the electrolyte will start flowing out of the semi-permeable membrane. So let us look, let us understand this concept from this diagram. So here in this diagram, this is the dialysis bag, this is the dialyzer, and we have a dialysis bag. It is filled with your colloidal solution that we want to make pure, and we are going for the purification of this colloid. So we put it inside the dialysis bag, and that bag is inserted inside a chamber. And in this chamber, you can see the fresh water is coming in and flowing out. So the fresh water that is flowing in, flowing out, it is taking along with it all the electrolytes that is coming out from the semi-permeable membrane or the dialysis bag. The molecules and the ions are diffused through the membrane into the outer water, and the pure colloidal solution is left behind. So these blue particles, they are basically representing the colloidal particles, right? They are the colloidal salt dispersed in the dispersion medium, but these ions, like you can see the negatively charged pink particles and positively charged green particles, they are the impurities of the electrolyte. Then we have these much smaller particles of other impurities. They are not ionic impurity, but yes, they are also a type of impurity. So these particles also, they can also pass through the membrane due to their smaller size. So what will happen when the this dialysis bag is put inside the continuously flowing fresh water, these particles will constantly come out of the dialysis bag. And after some time, what will happen? All the particles will come outside, and only the colloidal salt particles will remain inside the dialysis bag. So in this manner, the purification of colloid is completed. This is a simple dialysis process, and in this manner you can purify the colloidal salt. Then the second method we have for the purification of colloid is electrodialysis. So electrodialysis, this process is very much similar to the process of dialysis, but the only difference lies here is the application of the electric field. So electric field is applied here because the ordinary dialysis process, it is very slow process. this process takes a very long time to get complete, and therefore to in order to increase the rate of this reaction, to rate of this process, electric field could be applied. Now when the electric field is applied, what will happen? The movement of the ion will take place in a much faster manner, and your dialysis will be completed in very short time. So the process can be made faster by applying an electric field if the dissolved substance in the impure colloidal solution is only an electrolyte. So this is a condition for the electrodialysis process. Your colloidal salt, it should have only and only the electrolytic impurities. If these ionic impurities are the only impurity present in the colloidal salt, in that case you can use electrodialysis. So when you will apply the electric field around your dialysis bag, the movement of the ion will be fastened. Of course, if any other type of impurity is present in the salt, so it will not come out in the influence of the electric field. So you should be sure about that your colloidal salt is containing only the electrolytic impurity. So in that case, this process is very, very effective, and we call it electrodialysis. The colloidal solution is placed in a bag of a suitable membrane, with pure water is taken outside. All the setup is similar to the setup of the dialysis, but the only difference is electrodes are fitted in the compartment. So let us understand this with the help of a diagram. This process is very similar to the dialysis. Everything is all the setup of the apparatus is similar to the dialysis. Like we have a dialyzer bag here, dialyzing membrane, and the salt that is to be purified, it is filled inside the membrane, and you put it inside the continuously flowing water. Water is flowing in, water is flowing out, and what will happen under the concentration gradient, the impurities will come out. Here the brown particles are my salt particles, and they will remain inside the dialyzing membrane because their size is quite large and they cannot cross this membrane. But the crystalloids, or you can say the small impurities which are having charge, or the electrolytes, they will come out of the dialyzing membrane. Here you can see we have anode and cathode. The electrodes are fitted inside the chamber, and what will happen? The negatively charged impurities will be attracted by the anode, positively charged impurities will be attracted by the cathode, and this process will be very, very fast. Ions present in the colloidal solution migrate out to the oppositely charged electrodes. So during this process, there will be faster movement of ions. So this process is not only very fast, but also it is very, very effective. But the only condition lies here is your colloidal solid should have electrolytic impurities present in it. Now moving towards the next method, we have the method of ultrafiltration. So this ultrafiltration is the process of separating the colloidal particles from the solvent and the soluble solutes present in the colloidal solution by specially prepared filters which are permeable to all the substances except the colloidal particles. So this ultrafiltration is again, it is very much similar to the process of this dialysis, but here you are using the ultrafiltering membrane. So when you pass your colloidal salt through it, the salts will be retained by the membrane, and all the other impurity present, they will pass through the filter. Now the colloidal particle, they can pass through the ordinary filter paper because the pores are too large. So we cannot use the ordinary filter paper here. However, the pores of the filter paper can be reduced in size by impregnating with colloidal solution to stop the colloidal particle. So how you can develop a ultra filter? You need to reduce the size of the filter paper. So the pore size of the filter paper, it can be reduced when we impregnate that that filter paper by using some colloidal particle, colloidal solution. So when you dip a filter paper into a colloidal salt and you allow to dry it, then what will happen? The colloidal particles will be there around the pores of the filter paper, and now the pore size will be reduced. So now the colloidal particles, they are not able to pass through the filter paper. So this is one of the methods to prepare ultra filters. Now, what colloidal solution is used here? So, generally a 4% solution of nitrocellulose in a mixture of alcohol and ether. It is used for the impregnating of the filter paper. So, when such solution is used, what is the process of making an ultra filter paper? So, it can be prepared by soaking the filter paper in the colloidal solution, hardening by the formaldehyde, and then finally drying it. This is the method to prepare an ultra filter. Now, in this method, you are soaking the filter paper in a colloidal solution. And what is this colloidal solution? It is 4% solution of nitrocellulose. Then you harden it by formaldehyde, spray it with formaldehyde, and then finally you allow to dry. Now, because the pore size of such filter paper is reduced, so the large size colloidal particles, they are not able to pass through it. So what will happen when you pass your colloidal salt through such ultra filter? The colloidal particles are separated from rest of the material, and in this manner you will get a pure colloidal salt. So you achieve the purity. But the limitation is ultra filtration is a very slow process. So to speed up the process, the pressure or suction is applied. When you apply the suction, it will suck the impurity along with the dispersion medium. So then in that case, you can increase the speed of this process. The colloidal particle left on the ultra filter paper are then stirred with a fresh dispersion medium to get a pure colloidal solution. So what is happening here, when you are passing the colloidal solution through the ultra filter paper, all the dispersion medium along with the electrolyte is removed. So whatever type of impurity is present here, okay, it can be any electrolytic impurity or it can be a non-electrolytic impurity which is not carrying any charge. Whatever kind of impurity that is present in the colloid, that will be removed along with the dispersion medium if it is in the true solution form, right? And you will have only the pure colloidal particles over the top of the ultra filter. So now you remove those colloidal particles from the top of the filter, and then you mix them with some fresh dispersion medium, and again you get a pure colloidal solution. This is also a very effective method. Here you can see two diagrams. In the first diagram, a simple ultra filtering membrane is seen. Okay, so here is my ultra filtering membrane, and this is the impure colloidal solution. When the pressure is applied over it, what will happen? When you apply the pressure, it will force the dispersion medium to go to the next chamber separated by ultra filter, and only the colloidal particle which are of larger size, they will remain in on this side of the filter. So in this manner, all the impurities, irrespective of their nature, they will be removed from the colloidal particles along with the dispersion medium. So in order to increase the process, you apply pressure. This is another apparatus displaying the same concept. Here you can see a conical chamber. Here the gas is applied for putting pressure over the ultra filter. Okay, you need not to push that with your hand. When you pass the gas through it, when gas is supplied inside the chamber, it will put a pressure on the salt and electrolyte. This is my impure colloid solution. And when a pressure is applied over it, this ultra filter supported on the wire mesh, it will allow all the dispersion medium and impurity to pass through it. But the colloidal particles, they will be retained here. And when you separate them from the filter paper, then you can mix them with the dispersion medium, and a fresh colloidal salt can be prepared, which is having no impurities. The next method that we have is ultracentrifugation. Now, ultracentrifugation, it involves the separation of the colloidal particle from the impurities by centrifugal force. You may have read two types of forces, centrifugal force and centripetal force. So centripetal force, when a particle is moving continuously in a circular path, the force when it is applied towards the center, it is a centripetal force, and when the force is applied out of the center, it is centrifugal force. So basically these two forces, they depend upon the circular motion of the particle. So the centrifugal force is when centrifugal force is applied from the center of the circular path towards the outside. That is the centrifugal force. So when the centrifugal force is applied, in the process of centrifugation, the particles are separated according to their weight. Heavier size particle, they will remain, they will separate according to their weight, and smaller size particle, they will also separate according to their weight. So this centrifugation process is also very useful, and we are not using the normal centrifugation, rather we are using the ultra centrifugation method. So the colloidal particle, the impure salt is taken in a tube. In the centrifugation, we have a tube and you fill the impure salt inside that tube. That tube is placed in an ultra centrifuge, and what it does to the tube is rotated at high speed. The tube is there in the circular motion. It is rotated at very high speed. So what happens, the colloidal particle, they will settle down at the bottom of the tube and impurities remain in the solution. This solution is termed as the centrifugate. The settled colloidal particles are removed from the tube and mixed with an appropriate dispersion medium. Therefore, pure salt is obtained. So, in this method, you are not removing the electrolytes, rather you are removing the pure colloidal particles from the solution by centrifugation process. So, all the impurities, they will remain in the solution, but my colloidal particles, they will settle down at the bottom. And what will happen? You will now remove the colloidal particles and mix them with some dispersion medium and you get the pure salt solution again. By using the high speed centrifugal machine having 15,000 or more revolutions per minute, these machines are called ultra centrifuge. So the normal centrifuge and ultra centrifuge, what is the difference between them? The ultra centrifuge can rotate around the speed of about 15,000 or even the more revolution per minute. So they are actually displaying very high speed. So we call them ultra centrifuge. So in this diagram, you can see this test tube is containing the impure salt. Okay, impure salt, and my salt particles are what? They are the neem particles. Now, when the tube is rotated at very high speed, these green particles will be separated. After some time, the red particles are separated. Then in the next step, blue particles are separated. And finally, the black particles are separated. So, in the stepwise manner, I can separate whatever type of particle I want to separate from my colloidal solution. It depends on the molecular weight of the colloid also, that when it will get precipitated. So this is the process of ultra centrifugation, and with this topic we have seen how we can go for the purification of salt. So we have four methods for the purification of salt. Now moving forward in this unit, our next topic is optical properties of the colloids. What are the optical properties of colloids? So as its name suggests, optical properties are basically related with the behavior of light. When the colloid, they interact with some light or some radiation, what are their, what will be their behavior? So that will be the optical properties of colloid. So in this, in the optical properties, the first topic that we need to understand is the Faraday-Tyndall effect. Now you all must have heard about this Tyndall effect. So what happens when you pass a strong beam of light through a colloidal solution? The path of the light is illuminated and a visible cone is formed. So we call it what? We call it Faraday-Tyndall effect. And this phenomena results from the scattering of light by the colloidal particles. So as we all know that our colloidal particles, they are not settled at the bottom and they are not disappeared into the solution. Rather, they are still in the form of particle floating in the dispersion medium. So when you are passing a beam of light through the solution, there are so many solid particles floating in the medium, and when the light will fall on them, when the radiation will fall on them, they will scatter that radiation in all directions. So what will happen? When the strong beam of light is passing through it, the path of the light will be illuminated and a visible cone is formed. So you can imagine that Faraday Tyndall effect when in the morning, if you have a window in your home, so from that window, from the crevices of the doors, if you can see the sunlight is coming, and in that sunlight you can see so many dust particles floating inside the sunlight. So that is a display of a Tyndall effect in our daily life. And in that beam of the sunlight, you can see so many particles floating in the air, and a visible cone is formed. If you have observed that carefully, a visible cone is also formed there. So, the Faraday-Tyndall effect, it is a very characteristic property of collides. And this property, this optical property of collides, it separates them from all the other type of solutions. The scattering of light is not done by the two solutions, because all the particles are already disappeared into the dispersion medium. And this is also not shown by the suspension, because all the particles are settled down at the bottom of the container. So when the beam of light you are passing through it, there will be no particle to scatter the light. Only and only collides have this property that they can scatter the beam of light. And this phenomena is called as Faraday-Tyndall effect. So in this diagram, you can see this is my beam of light, suppose. And when you are flashing a torch here, this is my collider solution. The path of the light, it will be illuminated. So in whatever direction the collider particles, they are scattering the light, they will become visible, right? What does it mean by the illumination? So whenever the scattering of light takes place, it will come to your eyes and you can see, you can actually see the particle. So when you can see an object or a particle, when it reflects light, and that reflected light ray comes to your eyes. So in case of colloidal solution, that scattering is very common. Again, you can see here we have a laser beam. This is the traditional ionic silver, and when the beam of light is passing through the collider solution, when it is passing through the true solution, there is no illumination. But when it is passing through the amber collider silver, what will happen? The scattered light visible as a line. So this line is actually what? This is displaying the Faraday-Tyndall effect. When the silver was present in the ionic form, it is not scattering light because it has disappeared into the dispersion medium. But when it is present in the form of collide, okay, we have silver at both the beakers. Silver is present in both of the beakers, but here it is in the ionic form and here it is in the colloidal form. So in the ionic form, it cannot scatter the beam of light. But in the colloidal form, it is very well scattering the light, and the path of the beam is visible, or you can say that it is illuminated. So this is the Faraday-Tyndall effect, which is a very important property, very important optical property of the colloidal solutions. Then next we have the electron microscope. So electron microscope is capable of yielding the pictures of actual particle size, shape and structure of colloidal particles. So you may have heard about the electron microscope, where the in cases where we cannot use our simple microscope or our compound microscope, in that case you need to have an electron microscope. And these electron microscopic images, they have been used in the various areas to study different macromolecules. And in the electron microscope, in the place of a beam of light, rather electron beam is used. So at a very high speed, these electrons are also behaving like a radiation. That is due to the dual nature of the particle. So that electron beam is used in place of actual radiation, and these microscopes have a really high resolving power, because the radiation source is beam of high energy electron. Okay, so the resolving power is when you can identify the two different objects, that is the resolving power. If they are present so close to each other, and by using the microscope, if still you can identify them separately, then it is the resolving power. So the electron microscope, they have pretty high resolving power, because the only reason is they are using the electron beam source. So the resolving power is what? It is the smallest distance by which two objects are separated and yet they remain distinguishable. That is the resolving power. If a microscope is having lower resolving power, then what will happen? you cannot identify two different objects if they are placed at a smaller distance with each other. So you cannot identify them separately. So the resolving power in case of the optical microscope, it is very low, but in case of electron microscope, it is high. Smaller the wavelength, smaller will be the distance d. The beam of electron have wavelength 0.01 nanometer. Why they have a wavelength? Because here the particle, my electron is behaving like a radiation. It is behaving like a wave. And if it is behaving like a wave, then it must have some wavelength. So its wavelength is 0.01 nanometer. And it can measure the d, that is the resolving power, up to 0.5 nanometer. This is the electron microscope. Then the source of the electron, we have anode here. Then we have a condenser lens, scan foils, objective lens, sample. So again, this is the you can say this an optical property of a collider system. Secondary electron detector is also present here. This electron beam is traveling fast, and it identifies your object placed at the sample table. This is the same image, and you can see the particles here. They are whatever they are, maybe some kind of molecules. But in case of electron microscope, this is the resolving power that. Even at the microscopic level, even at the nano level of material, they can resolve the different particles. In the third point, we have to study the light scattering property of the collide. Again, it is very important, optical property of the collides. So it depends on the Tyndall effect. And it used to give information about the particle size and shape and for the molecular weight determination of the collides. So light scattering is when the light is reflected in a random direction. So you call it scattering. So when the particles are moving inside the collider solution, they scatter with the light, they scatter the radiation in random directions, and you call it what? Scattering. That scattering of light is actually providing a typical property to the collider solution, and this property is known as turbidity. So this type of the property, that is the scattering of the light, it can be used to determine the particle size, because that scattering will depend on the size of the particle. It will also depend on the shape of the particle, and you can also determine the molecular weight of the collider particles by using this light scattering property. This is used to study the proteins, association collides, and lyophobic salts. So especially these type of collider solutions, they can be studied by using the light scattering property. The scattering is described in terms of turbidity. Now let me explain you this turbidity with a very simple example. Suppose you have taken some mud and you put it inside a beaker and you add water. And after shaking vigorously, if you shake that beaker vigorously, some of the mud that will go inside the solution. And now you allow to settle the larger size particle. You just leave that beaker on the table for some time. And after some time, the sedimentation will take place. Right? And after the sedimentation, the large size mud particle, they will settle at the bottom of the beaker. But still, now I cannot separate the original water that I mixed with the mud. Now my water is what it is, you call it a muddy water. Like maybe you have seen in case of ponds, if you have seen the pond water, it is somewhat, you can say, muddy in appearance. So if you put a beaker inside the pond and you take the water and you look at it in the sunlight, you will see that the water is not pure, it is not colorless, which is generally said for pure water. Water is not colorless, rather it appears to be brown or a pale or a muddy color. So that color in the water, if you look carefully, you will see small, very small particles moving inside that beaker, and they are not going to settle down. For whatever time you allow that water to for the sedimentation, but that those particles, they will never settle down, and they are actually the colloidal particles. So these colloidal particles, they will do what? They are scattering the light. And earlier when you had a pure water in your beaker, in earlier case, it was passing all the lights through it. But when you have prepared a collagen solution, these very small particles, they are scattering the light, and now you can see a color in the water. So that color, or that is due to the movement of those small size particles, we call it for turbidity. So generally it is said that the pond water is turbid in nature. Turbidity is actually when water is the scattering light. Otherwise, pure water should pass all the light through it. So turbidity is what? Now we can define it. A fractional decrease in the intensity due to the scattering as the incident light passes through 1 centimeter of the solution. So what happens when a beam of light is passing through such solution, passing through the muddy water? What will happen? Due to the scattering of light, the intensity of light that is passing through the water, it will decrease. And sometimes even it does not reach to the other end of the beaker. So you are not receiving that on the other side. And when you see it like this, you are seeing a dark color in water, or you may have a muddy or pale color water. So this is the decrease in the intensity. And what is the reason of a decrease in intensity? It is due to scattering as the incident light passing through the solution. So when you can actually measure that scattering per centimeter of the solution, this is the turbidity. Now turbidity is actually proportional to the molecular weight of lyophilic colloid. Generally, such type of particles which are known for creating turbidity, they are lyophilic colloids, right? Lyophobic colloids, they are showing the property of this Tyndall effect, okay? But the lyophilic colloids, they are showing property of turbidity. So this property of turbidity, it can be correlated to the molecular weight of the lyophilic colloid. So T is turbidity is equal to intensity of the scattered light IS upon intensity of the incident light I. IS upon I, this is the turbidity value. So from this equation, you can, this is my turbidity T. Okay, H is constant for a particular system, C is the concentration of solution, M is the molecular weight, V is the interaction constant. From this equation, I can correlate the turbidity value with the molecular weight of a colloid. So, by using all these values, if you put their values, you can get the molecular weight of the lyophilic colloid from this equation. Generally, we measure turbidity by turbidity meter. It is very common instrument in laboratories. And when you place it has a small glass tube in which you put your solution and you put it inside the turbidity meter. When you switch on the turbidity meter, a beam of light passes through that test tube. And what happens? Test tube, rather you say it, cuvette. Small test tube, like small square test tube, they are called cuvettes. So when you put your solution inside the cuvette and then you place it inside the turbidity meter and allow the beam of light to pass through it, according to the turbidity of the solution, the intensity will be reduced. So in the turbidity meter, we are measuring the turbidity. What is the unit of turbidity? This will be your homework. You need to find out what is the IUPAC unit of turbidity. Okay. So when we will plot a graph against HC upon T and concentration of the colloid, here concentration of polymer is taken. Generally, polymers are also known as colloids because their particle size, it reaches to the colloidal level. So here the intercept on the HC upon T axis gives 1 upon N. Okay, this is my intercept. So this is the application for the polymers. In case of polymers, when you do not know what is the molecular weight of a polymer, because molecular weight of a polymer particle, it depends upon the extent of the polymerization. To what extent the polymerization is completed? So in that case, you need to calculate the molecular weight of the particle for each type of polymerization process. So when you plot a graph like this, HC upon T, with the concentration of the polymer, a straight line is obtained and the intercept here, it gives you 1 upon M. When you reciprocate it, you will get the molecular weight. So turbidity of the solution is measured at different concentration. to take the different polymer solution of same polymer but a different concentration. You measure the turbidity using a turbidity meter, and then after getting the values of the turbidity, this H is a constant, you plot a graph like this, and in this manner you can calculate the molecular weight of the polymer which is actually in the colloidal form. So this is actually one of the applications with the help of which you can find out molecular weight of polymer particles. If the molecule or particle is asymmetric, the intensity of the scattered light varies with angle of observation. So when light is getting scattered in all the possible directions, so it is also very important that from which angle you are observing it, right? According to the angle of the observation, the molecular particle, the intensity of the scattered light could be different in different directions. So from this data, we can estimate the shape and size of the particle. Like suppose if the shape of the particle is symmetric in nature, then it will scatter the same amount of light in all the directions, right? But if in all the directions the scattering level is different, so you can say that the shape is asymmetric in nature. So you can actually estimate what amount of light is scattered in which direction, and by that data you can determine the shape and size of the particle. Now in the quasi-elastic light scattering technique, it allows the examination of the heparin in aggregate in the commercial preparation stored at various periods. So heparin is a commercially very important compound, and with the help of this quasi-electric light scattering technique, you can actually know what is the shelf life of that heparin. So light scattering and micelle molecular weight. Micelle is again, they are the type of colloidal particle. So the turbidity of the surfactant solution depends on the amphiphilic monomer, amphiphilic aggregate. Total C total is a concentration. Total concentration is concentration of monomer and concentration of the micelle. Monomer is, it is not a colloidal particle, right? Micelle is the colloidal particle. So this is again an example of the optical property of colloidal solution, and that you can use to count the critical micellar concentration of a monomer. So because the polymers have actually reached the colloidal size during the polymerization process, several colloidal properties, they can be used to calculate different properties of the polymer. So here the critical micellar concentration, that is CMC, it can be determined for a monomer. Now I have two questions for you. Give any daily life example of Tyndall effect. So I have just explained you the example of Tyndall effect when the sunlight is coming through the crevices of your door or window, then in that case you can see a visible cone and the dust particles scattering inside it. So I would like you to observe such effect at your home so that you can realize what it is actually. Then my second question is, what is difference between dialysis and electrodialysis? So if you have seen this lecture throughout, you can tell me what is dialysis and what is electrodialysis. The simple difference is application of the electric field. Okay, so please go through the lecture carefully and try to find out the answer of these questions. That is all from my side. Thank you everyone for joining.